Hi, I'm Laura Campbell, and I serve on the Carmel City Council. I'm also one of the founders of the Carmel Advisory Committee on Disability and a member of the committee's Employment Issues Subcommittee. I would like to introduce the other committee members who are here today. If you want to wave your hand, Kelly Freeman, Transition Coordinator for Carmel Clay Schools. Michelle Leakes, who is Employee Benefits Manager in the City of Carmel's Human Resource Department, and Lyle Leakty, who is a parent of a daughter with special needs. We have several panelists with us today with ties to Carmel to discuss disability employment issues, and we would like each panelist to just give a short introduction, starting with Lexi here.
Hi, thank you so much for having me. As Laura said, my name is Lexi here, and I currently work at Brawn Ability as a staff accountant. I've been working at Brawn Ability for about a year as a full-time staff accountant. And then I guess one thing I guess that's unique about me that I do in my free time is I play a sport called power soccer. It's a sport specifically designed for people with a physical disability that makes them be in a wheelchair. And I've been playing the sport for about, longer than I can remember, since I was five, and I'm 24 now. So I've been playing a long time, and I've been able to travel throughout the world through soccer, and I love it, and it's something that's close to my heart.
Very good. Thanks for joining us. We also have Olivia Young. Olivia, would you like to introduce yourself?
Yeah, hi. I'm Olivia Young. I'm with a company called JEC. It's James Emmett and Company. And what we are doing, we have this initiative to join hands with companies, and we're working with Telemon right now. We're all over the country, but Telemon is where we're focusing on in Carmel right now. And it's a telecommunications warehouse positions that they have available, and they are so accommodating there, and we're really wanting to get out into the disability world and spread the word on their accommodations, and they have this extreme initiative to hire.
That's great. And Kelly Freeman, she's a member of our committee, but Kelly, want to introduce yourself? You're also going to serve as a panelist today.
Double duty. Yes, my name is Kelly Freeman. I am the transition coordinator for Carmel Clay Schools. And one portion of my job is to facilitate vocational training for individuals with disabilities, whether they're getting a diploma or they're not getting a diploma. We help individuals find jobs, but the bigger thing we do is help teach the skills that are going to help them maintain and keep employment. We often have individuals who can do the job, but sometimes it's the other things that keep them from being successful or maintaining employment in the long run.
Very good. Thank you. So let's get started with Lexi. Lexi, if you could kind of talk about your background leading up to your employment at Brawn Ability.
Yeah, absolutely. So I grew up in Fishers. I graduated from Fishers High School in 2015, and then I went on to Ball State, and I graduated in December of 19. From there, I had my bachelor's in accounting and economics. And throughout my time at Ball State, I had three different internships. And so my first internship that I had, I was a full-time tax intern at Crow. I did a busy season there. I took a semester off from school and got to get in real deep into busy season with that. And then my second internship that I did, I was also an intern down at Eskenazi. And I was interning through the Gregory S. Fairbox Center. And what that is, that center was designed to help people with physical disabilities get work experience and internship. And they provide like housing down there for people that don't live close to downtown, and it's a paid internship as well too. And so they give good quality experience for people with physical disabilities to just to help them get a good idea of of the working world. And so I interned there during a summer, and I was an intern in their business development and strategy group. I really enjoyed that internship, and that really showed me a lot. This group that I was a part of really showed me how the whole business together works, especially when they're thinking about buying a new piece of equipment and how they can market that to their clientele and stuff. So I really enjoyed that internship there. And then the last internship I had was with Brawn Ability. It was during my last semester at Ball State. I interned with them part-time in their finance accounting group. And then I've just been with them ever since, and I've loved Brawn Ability and working there. And
that's great. So how has your job changed or during the pandemic?
Yeah, so before I was in the office in Carmel Hall 5 days a week, but since pandemic, I've pretty much just been at home. The office, our Carmel office is open now, but I sort of only just go in if I need to. So I've pretty much just been from home since then.
Very good. Kelly, if you could speak about transition issues from high school to work, what families, potential employees, and employers should expect?
Well, I think the big difference, the big thing that families and individuals have to begin to understand, and it's difficult at first, is that the work world doesn't always work like the high school setting, where there's a lot, at the high school setting, there's a lot of accommodations that are made, there's exceptions that are made, but in the work world, if somebody's has a paid job, they're expected to perform that job at whatever level they're supposed to be performing it. And I think that's a big adjustment often for individuals and families to understand that, you know, it's not okay to be late six times, or, you know, while at the high school setting, that might be okay, or you might not even have to get to your class on time. But when you're at a job, you really do have to be there on time, and you have to show up and do your job. That's a big adjustment, I think, whether individuals are going to the work world or going to college. I mean, you leave this world of entitlement through Article 7 into a world where you have to be eligible for services. And I think that's sometimes an adjustment for families. And I don't know that we talk about it as often as maybe we should in our K-12 world, because we're just doing what we do, and that's what we do. And we always wait till it gets to be closer before to exit before we start maybe talking about some of those things. And as in a lot of things in life, you don't really understand it till you experience it. So that's a big adjustment for a lot of families. For employers, we, of course, are so fortunate to be here in Carmel, where we have so many businesses that are so willing to hire our individuals. Whether it's an individual with a cognitive disability or an individual with a physical disability or just somebody who struggles socially, maybe because of autism or something like that. We have so many businesses that are willing to work with our job coaches and get individuals into the businesses and work with us. I think a big adjustment, again, for employers is we struggle sometimes getting employers to maybe treat our individual just like they would any other employee. And I don't mean that in a bad way. I mean, sometimes they're too accommodating, or they're too, they'll make some exceptions where we might think, well, do you let other employees do that? And they'll say no. And then you shouldn't let our employee do that. So it's those same kind of things. I'm probably going beyond your question here. But those are kind of the things that we run into when it comes to getting individuals jobs and being in the work world. It's just one of those big life lessons that you start learning once you start doing it.
Sure. And Olivia, I noticed you were nodding your head. Have you experienced that as well with employers?
I can completely see that happening. And that, which I'm sure we'll discuss, but that actually goes into part of our training as well, that JEC goes into to these corporations and discusses with them and has a whole training session on how to employ individuals with different needs. So I think that's extremely important on getting that background, getting that training. And it goes from corporate level all the way down, you know, to the specific supervisors, which is the biggest benefit that for both parties that I think is extremely needed.
Olivia, I'm sure you, oh, is it okay for me to jump in there? Okay. Olivia, I'm sure you've also seen that often our individuals are the best employees because they're there Absolutely. On time. We kind of train them the right way. We had an individual that stocked shelves at a business and he did it the exact right way every time. And other stores would be like, well, how are you guys getting this done and getting these awards for this? But our store's not. Well, it's because our individual did it the exact same way every time, exactly as he was trained. And so that piece of being having a job coach and being trained the exact right way, often employers find that our individuals stick around. We have some individuals who've exited our vocational training program, 5 or 6 years ago. Well, now this was before COVID, so I'm assuming they're still in their jobs now. But it's sometimes, especially if you have an individual that has a cognitive disability, they don't always maintain employment over long periods of time. And so when you can get somebody who's maintaining employment for several years, that's a big win for everybody.
Absolutely. And that's what we, tell our customers as well. We're here to get you quality candidates. And then on the other side of that, they're going to last too. So that is something we get told that all the time, JEC clients, Sycamore Services, this, that, they're our best performers. And we're like, we told you that's what we're here to do. We're here to spread that word.
Sure. Great points. Lexi, what would you like employers to know about hiring an employee with a disability?
Yeah, I think one thing that, as you guys have both said, that, the expectation should be the same with someone with a disability, and that also that the access to opportunity should be the same too. And, there's been a lot of talk lately about how to increase equity among minorities in the workforce and workplace. And I don't know if you guys knew, but people with disabilities are the largest minority in the nation. And so I think employers need to just not assume things and have perceived like additional expenses when you see someone with a disability. Rather, look at them as an asset, an opportunity. What can they provide to my company, as you would with any individual?
Sure. So I'm going to turn it over to my committee, and starting with Kelly Freeman, we're going to take turns asking questions. So Kelly, you're up.
So Olivia, this probably would fit your area and you might be able to answer. When you're working with companies and you're going in and you're training them, this is how we would like for you to work with our individuals. What do you tell them about how to interact and how to use a job coach? I find that for us, my job coaches, I feel like, of course I'm biased, do an amazing job. Right. But we're a little different in that they can be in a business. If we have an individual that needs somebody with them every shift, the entire school year, we can do that. Whereas when an individual is being supported by vocational rehabilitation or an agency, they're a little more limited. So I've always been curious as to what it is businesses expect from a job coach.
Exactly that. What I've especially experienced with Telemon specifically, who has been honestly one of the best companies I've ever worked with in this, is they're extremely welcoming to job coaches for those first, however long it takes that candidate to feel comfortable with the job. There's no time limit. Everyone's different and they know that. And they can be there, right there, hands-on. They can help them fill out their paperwork and everything like that. I think they just, what I've known from Telemon is as long as there's progress, that's all they care about. They want to see progress, and that is completely understandable from a work side. They do have the same expectations, but they also, and they've said that about any candidate, as long as we see progress, the main reason people get fired, she said, is attendance. She said that is really our only reason why people get, other than safety, if there was a safety problem, but we take all the precautions and training, and they take it all very seriously. But they're on the other side of that as well. I made sure with Tabby, I said, who is the HR with Telemon, what happens if someone's not performing where in that section? If you, do you feel like it is a lazy problem, or do you, if it's not, you see them trying, what do you do then? And she said, we have so many different options. That's when I would contact the job coach or me and say, hey, it's not working out here. Let's sit down with our candidate and let's talk about maybe moving them to a different area. And I thought that was extremely amazing, because a lot of these warehouse positions are just like, okay, it didn't work. We're done. And I've actually already had two people fill out applications and are getting hired, and we're doing direct hiring there. And I think that's important as well, that these candidates feel that security of a long-term employment, if that makes sense.
It does. And I agree. It's you see a lot of progress and you see a lot of long-term employment when you can get the job coach and then eventually the family, because when the student right. ages out of our programs, then the family has to get involved. And then if they have a relationship with the business, then that individual can stay employed a lot longer. And I think that's right. that's really key, that everyone's on the same page. And I think we have to always realize too that some businesses are always going to be better at it than others. And so you have right. to kind of find those niches of where, you know, somebody's going to really be supportive and encouraging, yet hold people accountable. And I love what Lexi said about giving everybody the same opportunity. Sometimes an individual will get hired in doing X, Y, and Z, and they'll see other things they'd like to do. But sometimes a manager will think, oh, we can't do that because we only showed them this portion, when our individuals often can expand into many other things. So those are all great points.
Very good. Third question, I'll turn it over to Lyle.
Yeah, thank you. I was wondering if you could tell us from your standpoint, Olivia, that is there anything you wish an individual with a disability would do differently when they apply for a job, or anything that you wish a person would with a disability would share with you when applying or when they're first hired for a job?
I wouldn't say that I wish they would do. I think I've trial and error, right? I think I have gone about my interview questions. I've worked on that on my side just to dig in deeper with whatever they're comfortable sharing. I that is completely up to them. And just, I just ask, do you have any restrictions? Do you have any things that we need to work on and see what we can do if for that specific position? And if and what we're doing for that candidate, I would say, is we're doing a candidate tour. Now, this isn't in all of the workplaces out there. I think... I don't believe that there's anything that they can be doing differently. I think we've opened up this idea of doing a candidate tour so that they can come in and ask questions, see exactly what they're going to be doing, and then ask those questions. Because originally my answer would be ask questions about the job, you know, feel comfortable asking those questions, because that's what I'm here for. But with that candidate tour, it opens up their mind to like, know what they're going to be doing and what kind of questions that they would have then to fully understand the job position.
So Olivia, it sounds like education on both sides is a part
absolutely
of this process and having some success with this process then.
Yes, definitely. Definitely. I mean, I've gone through so much training and they've got, you know, Telemon's even gone through so much training. And like I said, it's building that relationship, which I think is the most important part of it.
So, Olivia, along those lines, what do you do when you approach a business? Do you, show the benefits of hiring people with disabilities, or are these companies that typically reach out to you?
It can go definitely one of or both ways. Typically, if we see, hey, this could be a great fit, we see so much potential in this company, we'll reach out and we'll tell them, hey, here, you know, everyone's got all the statistics if they just looked into it. There are so many benefits to hiring people with this different needs. And And let's tap into that. Just like Lexi said, that's a huge market of candidates that people don't even put a thought into. And why not? That is the largest minority group, like she said. And my thought is, and what I've explained to you is, there are so many people out there that don't even know to have access to, you know, the Sycamore Services, the Best Buddies, those kind of things. That's why I put, I went vulnerable and put my, you know, information out there as well, and my experiences to, hey, I understand what everyone's going through, and let's do something about it. Let's, you know, I have this great opportunity to reach out, and that's, you know, that's what I want to do. So I think both, like, we reach out to both, but we've also had a lot of people of companies see the success of Telemon, of other places, and then they're like, okay, we went on that too, you know. So it's been great success for us.
Very good. Michelle, you're up next. You're on mute.
I wasn't supposed to be that person. Guess there has to be one in the bunch. Sorry, guys. Thank you. So I guess along those efforts then, what does recruiting look like? Olivia, do you help companies, or do you have them approach their recruiting efforts differently? And does Bron, Lexi do anything from an employer perspective? Do they kind of tap into employees to ask them to help with their recruiting efforts? Like, do you feel that recruiting, I guess, is any different when you're trying to hire a diverse group of able employees or people?
Yeah. I think with, at least at Bron, you know, I don't think they treat anyone any differently from one person to the next. I think, especially in this past year, with everything that's been going on, I think we've had more of a focus of just treating everyone the same and not going in thinking one thing from interview to interview, and just going with an open mind. And I know with, especially at Bron too, that we do have we want to get other individuals with disabilities in our workforce, just because so much of what Bron does, right, we serve that population, and especially at Carmel too, that the office that we have is set up so perfectly for someone with a disability, and so that for me personally, that was a big reason why I chose Bron too. It's because of how accessible it was for me.
Nice.
Very good. Do any other committee members have a question they would like to ask?
I did. So I don't know, Olivia, if you helped with the interview and the hiring process, but you did kind of mention that. But when it comes to training and frontline managers, do you get involved at all with helping the companies that you work with train their frontline managers and people that are actually going to be responsible for the day-to-day work of those employees? What does that look like? Does that look any different to accommodate those needs?
I wouldn't say different. What we do as a company, a service that we offer, is that initial training to, like I said, everyone up in corporate down to the direct supervisors that would be working day-to-day. What it is we, with COVID, it's normally in person, but John Stoops, who is my boss, would come in and do the whole training. And right now it's virtually through Teams, but he'll give all the background of, you know, what we do and stuff like that, and why it's so important to hire individuals with different needs, and also going into the depth of, hey, don't treat them any differently. We know that they have expectations to meet, and also don't accommodate for everything. The reason for that is you may be getting in their way. They might like to, you know, just focus and work on their work, which is actually happens quite often, and they're very productive. I would say I lost my train of thought. But the training is all about the same. And what to answer, you know, your question for Lexi and I, our recruiting is the same. We do it virtually, Facebook groups, just like other companies do. We just put out there that, you know, we're reaching out for people with disabilities, but it is the exact same ad setup, everything. We also go to, you know, all the organizations throughout the Indy area and just try and work with them. We are that bridge for these organizations to get their foot in the door, and that's what we want.
Well, and Olivia, that's how I met you, through social media. You put out a request for employees. So I think social media, while some of us struggle with it, I think it does have some benefits of connecting us, especially during the pandemic. And as Lexi talked about working from home, you know, this has really changed the workplace, you know, having to adapt to virtual meetings. And so it's good to hear that this is something that you've been using and probably will continue to use.
Yes, it's definitely been, I think it's been very beneficial for everyone, for sure.
This is Lyle. I just wanted to make a couple comments. One is, I read last year, before the COVID, that there are companies around the country that are interviewing to accommodate people. Microsoft, for example, has changed some interviewing techniques for people with autism. And so even though it may not be needed, there are ways to do it so that that candidate can get a full, fair evaluation to be considered. And I'm sure there's lots of companies that do that now. And I know when our daughter was interviewed at a restaurant, that she interviewed for the manager and the assistant manager, and then the job coach I introduced, and they worked it out. And so the other thing that was nice about, she got accustomed to working there and went in and clocked in and so forth. She had soft support, like the employees all, you know, would know her, but they wouldn't interfere with her, but they would engage with her just socially, so she felt comfortable. And so I think that's important for, depending on the type of job, you know, in a restaurant, it's different. So you have to decide if that's a good fit, if somebody can be let go and then have that soft support, and then the job coach goes away. But people like Kelly, Caroline went through her program, that was a lifesaver because it helped her to go to Project Search. And then she started her own walking business for a year and then went into the real workforce, you know. So there's all kind of ways we can help, but I think that it's real impressive what you've all done, and we want to help people that are the most unemployed, you know, have the chance to contribute to the workforce.
Yeah, and that's a goal. One of the goals of this committee is to educate area employers about the benefits of hiring people with disabilities, and to get them accustomed to what's needed to hire people. And I think this is a really good start for us to have this discussion. Lexi, is there anything you would like to add, or Olivia, that you think that we need to highlight?
I think just the biggest thing with employers is just to be transparent with the person with the disability, and to, because I've been through so many different interviews through public accounting, and body language says a lot. And I think that I definitely had some firms where I was interviewing, I could totally tell they didn't care that I was in a chair. And I had other firms that, yeah, I could tell, they were hesitant about it. And so I would say body language says a lot. And then I'd also say that firms that I went through the hiring process that were really good and knew that, some of them knew that I was in a chair before coming in. And so they thought ahead, oh, we don't have door buttons for you to get in. But they brought that up, and they were like, if you need help when you get in, feel free to call when you get here, and we'll send someone down to help you get in. So just small things, but things that do matter.
Good. Olivia, does that kind of follow with the education portion that you discussed when you work with an employer?
Yeah, absolutely. So what I'll do is I'll do a facility tour before we even start a hiring process. And, you know, I make a very, very detailed list of things that I would think of, but that an employer might not. So speaking of, Lexi, like how wide doors are, do they have a push button to get in? What does clocking in and clocking out look like? Is that going to be difficult for, you know, to learn and think just little things like that, that again, an employer might not think about on a day to day, but we do. And that's what we're here to help that company with and build that relationship again, like I said. And that's that I'm actually doing all the interviewing and hiring for Telemon. That I think is really nice, but they also still meet with Tabby and do that candidate tour. So again, it's just about building that relationship and having the open communication, which I think is just absolutely dire when you're doing stuff like this. And again, it's proven to be successful. So that's where the hope is, right? So no, I'm very excited about this initiative.
Great. Well, and I look forward to having you and Lexi both give us input. We're kind of a new committee, but would love to have you weigh in on some of our committee meetings in the future. So, and we're getting to the end of our time, but I want to thank Lexi and Kelly and Olivia for participating in this panel today. And if anybody would like more information about the Carmel Advisory Committee on Disability, you can go to www.carmel.in.gov for more information. Thank you again for joining us today. And again, we look forward to your future input.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.